कॉन्सेंट्रेटेड सॉल्यूशन ऑफ सॉल्ट फॉर्म्ड बाय दैट बेस विथ स्ट्रॉन्ग एसिड. वॉट डज दिस मीन्स दैट यू आर टेकिंग वीक बेस. ओके, लाइक यू हैव सपोज NH4OH, यू टेक NH4OH, यू आर मिक्सिंग इट विद द बेस दैट सॉल्ट ऑफ दैट बेस. मीन्स यू हैव एनी अदर एसिड. ओके, सपोज अज्यूम इट आई एम टेकिंग HCl. सो दैट HCl प्लस NH4OH, वॉट एवर सॉल्ट दैट इज NH4Cl सॉल्ट जनरेटेड इन द प्रोसेस इज बेसिकली रिएक्टेड विथ योर वीक बेस दैट इज NH4OH. सो मिक्सचर ऑफ NH4OH एंड NH4Cl दैट इज अमोनियम हाइड्रोक्साइड एंड अमोनियम क्लोराइड इज बेसिकली एक्टिंग एज योर बेसिक बफर सॉल्यूशन. लुकिंग एट द एप्लीकेशंस ऑफ द बफर सॉल्यूशन, just like pH, buffer solutions also are very important in the life. You can see here playing important role in the textile field, dyeing industries, paper production, sugar industries. Also the buffer solutions plays very important role in preparation of the synthetic foods that are available. Also they play very important role in chemical reactions like estimating hardness of the water. Okay, so these are the applications of the buffer solutions. Coming to the Faraday's law of electrolysis, the Faraday, that is scientist Michael Faraday, during 1832 to 1833 studied the phenomena of electrolysis. We have already now seen what is this electrolysis. This electrolysis phenomena was studied by Michael Faraday, and on basis of that he gave the two laws that are the fundamental laws of electrolysis, whose mathematical form that I will be discussing later on. But let us try to look at the sentences of this law. The first law, that is Michael Faraday's first law of electrolysis, it states that amount of any substance that is liberated at electrode during electrolysis is proportional to quantity of current passed through electrolyte. What does this means? That the weight of substance that is liberated, or weight of mass that is liberated, you can say that is basically proportional to the quantity of current that you are passing through that particular electrolyte. So you can say mass liberated is proportional directly to the quantity of current passed. Look here, the second law of electrolysis given by the Faraday, that is, it states that when same quantity of electricity is passed through series of electrolyte, the amount of substance liberated at different electrolytes are proportional to their chemical equivalent weight of substance. I'll take in detail each points. What is this chemical equivalent? What is electrochemical equivalent? Let us try to understand this. Look here, the Faraday's law of electrolysis involve these of the terms. Let us try to understand it. You have basically the second law is using the term chemical equivalent of the substance. It means what? Chemical equivalent is basically Faraday's constant, that is 96,500, into electrochemical equivalent. Whenever you are multiplying these two terms, then you get directly the chemical equivalent. Now, what is electrochemical equivalent? Let us take a look. It is mass liberated by passing 1 ampere current for 1 second. It means what? Your electrochemical equivalent, that is indicated as a Z, capital Z, that is basically the mass liberated by passing 1 ampere current for 1 second. Okay, so this one has to remember. Now let us try to understand what is basically the difference between electrolytic conductance and metallic conductance. Very important, metals are the conductors of the electricity, and due to this we have to study what is happening into the solution, what is happening into the metals. Let us try to first study the electrolytic conductance. Now look here, whenever in the solution you are talking of the conductance, it means you can say very quickly that electricity is conducted by movement of the ions in electrolytic conductance. Second point, that is chemical reactions takes place at electrode, okay, in case of electrolytic conductance. Third point, transfer of matter takes place in the process. And the fourth point, conductance is always going to increase with increase in the temperature for electrolytes. Let us go ahead here comparing the metallic conductance just opposite to it. Here electricity is conducted by movement of electrons. You see here there is no chemical reaction involved in the process. Then there is no transfer of metal that is taking place in the process. And here you can understand that conductance is basically going to decrease with increase in the temperature. So just we can see and compare the four points of the metallic conductance and electrolytic conductance, which are just opposite to each other. Now what are the factors? Let us try to see what are the factors that is affecting the conductivity of the electrolyte solution. Okay, you can see here the nature of the electrolyte. Just like the factors affecting ionization, we also have the factors affecting conductivity of the electrolyte. The first point, that is nature of electrolyte. If you have a very strong electrolyte, then what will happen? Then it will undergo very good ionization, and hence the conductivity will be more for strong electrolyte. For weak electrolyte, it will undergo less ionization, and hence the conductivity will be less for weak electrolyte. Second point, that is concentration of the solution, or you can also say dilution of the solution. What does this mean? You have, suppose you have a diluted solution and you are adding, again diluting it further and further, that is you are reducing the concentration, then what will happen? Ionization will increase, and hence the conductivity of the electrolyte will also increase with increase in dilution of the solution. Temperature, you can say very easily that temperature, whenever temperature increases, conductivity of the electrolyte also increase. Viscosity of the solvent, if our solvent is having higher viscosity, then what will happen? There will be less ionization, and hence there will be conduction will be also less. So conductivity of the electrolyte will be less if viscosity of the solvent is more. Next factor is ionic attraction. Suppose you have more ionic attraction between the ions, then what will happen? It will be very less ionization, and again your conduction of the electrolyte will be going to decrease. So these are the very important factors: nature of the electrolyte, concentration of the solution, or you can also say dilution of the solution, then temperature, then you have viscosity of the solvent, ionic attraction. These are the factors. Let us move ahead discussing the physical factors. Okay, what are the physical properties that are associated with this solutions? Let us try to study Ohm's law, a very basic fundamental of this. You all have studied it. The strength of current flowing through conductor is directly proportional to potential difference applied across the conductor and inversely related to resistance of the conductor. It means what? I is the strength of current, E is potential difference, divided by R is the resistance of the conductor. You can say here specific conductance. I will also teach how these units are existing. We will derive certain units on definitions itself. Basically, specific conductance is defined as conductance of 1 cm³ of substance or solution, and unit is ohm inverse, centimeter inverse. That will be looking into zone later on how this unit has come. Equivalent conductance, if you see here, product of specific conductivity and volume of solution containing 1 gram equivalent of solute is called equivalent conductance. Now let us try to see effect of dilution on electrical conductance. We have already seen, right? Now how, what happens to the conduction when we are diluting the solution? We can basically understand. Suppose we have a strong electrolytes, then what happens here? There is very little increase in molar conductance with dilution. Okay, this has to be kept in mind. But for the case of the weak electrolyte, there is a sharp increase. Instantly there is a very less rise, then it increases very sharply with the molar conductance, okay, in dilution of the solution. That one has to keep in mind. We can understand the concept by drawing the graph here. We can draw this graph, that is graph is here equivalent conductance. Okay, this is our graph, and here is under root of C, that is square root of the concentration. Suppose if I have here 0.1 concentration, 0.2, then we have 0.3. If I have the graph of 10, 20, 30, 40, something like this, then whatever is said, we can see here, for the case of the strong electrolytes, that is, you can see here for NaCl type of thing, okay, there is not sharp change, okay, there is not sharp change in conductance. But when you are discussing the weak electrolytes, that is acetic acid, then you can straightway see there the graph is going to come like this. For the case of the acetic acid, that is CH3COOH. So this graph is indicating basically how your conductance is getting affected with the help of your dilution. Okay, moving ahead, that is, you have a N type of semiconductor. Okay, semiconductors, that is of N type. Why it is called N type? Because it is negatively type charge carrier is there in this semiconductor. You can look here, it is formed by addition of pentavalent impurity of arsenic in silicon or germanium. Okay, so you have a pentavalent impurity, that is arsenic, okay, that is having excess of the electrons. Okay, and what happens, this pentavalent impurity you are adding into what, into tetravalent compounds, that is silicon or germanium. Then what happens, your four electrons will form a bond with the four electrons of the arsenic, but the fifth electron, that is extra electron, is basically free here, and this electron is basically responsible for conduction in the case of the semiconductors. And this conduction of electricity here is due to electrons, so electrons are basically negatively charged carrier, and that's why it is known as N-type semiconductor. If you see here, P-type semiconductor, okay, P-type semiconductor is basically formed by addition of trivalent impurity of aluminium in silicon or germanium. So what happens here, holes are generated in the process, and holes are basically the positively charged, okay, and that's why here the conduction of electricity occurs due to mobility of these holes, and that is why it is called as P-type semiconductor, that is positively charged carrier. Here conduction occurs due to positive charge carrier, that are holes, and in case of N-type semiconductor, conduction occurs because of negatively charged carriers, that is electrons. Let us try to move ahead with the different concepts, that is related to your electroplating. Let us try to understand it. Now, electroplating, this is a very important concept that is used in the industries, okay, to coat the articles of the iron with the different metals. And this electroplating basically plays a very important role for the protection of the metal as well as for decoration of the metals. If you try to understand it, why this process plays very important role, let us see that. Electroplating, if you see here, iron articles can be coated with the chromium, nickel, tin, zinc, etc. by this process, that is known as electroplating. You are basically plating one metal on another metal by passing the current, and that is why this process is known as electroplating process. Okay, let us try to understand this concept. Suppose I am having an iron spoon here. Look here, I am having an iron spoon, that is basically my article which I want to coat. If you see here very clearly, the metal which we want to coat on this iron spoon is basically acting as your anode. Suppose I want to coat a chromium on this iron spoon, then what I will take? I will take chromium as an anode here, okay? I will take here as an anode, then The same solution that is made up of the same ions, that is, I'll take Cr2O3 salt dissolved in H2SO4. So my electrolyte will also will consist of the chromium ions. Now what will I do? See here, I will pass a electric current into the process, and what will happen? This chromium ions, okay, it will start coming down of this strip, that is anode. It will pass into solutions, and with the help of this solution, it will go and sit on the surface of the iron spoon. And this is how our entire iron spoon will get coated with our chromium. Okay, so suppose if I want to coat this spoon with the nickel, then what will I do? I will take a nickel anode here, nickel rod as an anode here, okay, and I will take a nickel salt solution here as a electrolyte. So by this time we have already understood that anode is what? It is positively charged electrode, and cathode is what? Negatively charged electrode. And electrolyte is what? Salt solution, okay, which has capacity to get converted into ions when electricity is passed through it. And what happens? This is a metal on which we are doing the coating. So this iron spoon is known as our base metal, and this is a strip whose coating, this is a metal which we have chosen basically to coat this spoon. So this strip is known as our coating metal. There are two concepts that one has to remember. One is base metal and another is coating metal. If you see here, our base metal is our spoon and our coating metal is our chromium strip that is acting as our anode. Let us try to understand very important thing, that is our electroplating. Now what happens in the process? If you see here very clearly electroplating, then this is a very important method that is used basically for the printing purpose. Okay, for printing in the press, you can say that we need alphabets or say letters, whatever we wish. For that, electrotyping method is very important. It is basically following the principles of the electrolysis. You can see here what I have taken. We have a copper electrode, okay, then we have copper sulfate salt solution, that is our electrolyte. Then we have here a block of the wax, okay, and on that what we have done, we have just embossed the alphabets which we want.